Thanks very much for coming out today. My name's Tim McGurthy. I'm the Executive Director of the Worcester Regional Research Bureau. We were formed in 1985 to help support good government, good public policy in the Worcester region. Our focus is making sure there's informed public debate when it comes to making decisions about the future of the city, the future of the region. I want to thank you all for coming today, and Harold Naughton's office, who is here as well. I appreciate the participation. This is the critical reason for the Research Bureau's founding 30 years ago, was how is municipal budget making, how is municipal finance doing, what are the things to look out for, and making sure that decisions being made on an annual basis as it comes to money, income, revenues, expenditures, is based on a sound understanding of the expectations of the future, the challenges of the future. And so this brings us right back to really the underlying reason for the Research Bureau's purpose in the first place. We've grown and expanded in range over the years, but this is kind of our beginnings. I want to thank our sponsors, Commerce Bank. Brian Thompson is here. Mike is here from Commerce Bank, who has been a staunch supporter of the Research Bureau for years now and our primary sponsor. I also want to thank Polar Beverages. Mike Mulrain is here. I saw Mike. Harvard Pilgrim, Saint-Gobain, who also have been key sponsors for the Research Bureau over the years. We're pleased to have a high level of support from the business community, the philanthropic community every year. I also want to acknowledge Mass College of Pharmacy, which has provided the space here. As always, they've been gracious hosts to the Research Bureau for our events every year. And I want to thank our panelists. We have a great panel for you today of folks who have been involved in the issue of municipal finance at both the local level and at the state level. Those who are kind of very familiar with the intricacies of budgeting and financing municipal operations. Importantly, and I will turn it over, I want to thank our moderator, John Robertson from the Mass Municipal Association, who's going to lead our panel in this discussion. John.
Thank you. Great pleasure to be here to moderate the panel. I think my job is really easy, keep the sort of the trains running on time, so there's plenty of time for questions and answers at the end. This is a very timely topic, as we're all at the state and local level going through sort of the budget preparation process, both trying to make things balance for FY18, but at the same time sort of look out what the future might bring in terms of trends locally, what's happening in state government, and certainly looking out at what's happening at the federal level as well. It's a great pleasure to be here, coming back to the city where I not only was born, but went to high school in Worcester. So it's always a good time to come here rather than travel east to Boston in the morning. What I want to do is start with Sean Cronin first, who's going to lead off and give something of the state perspective before we head into our great panel of local officials from central Massachusetts. Sean, as you may know, is the head of the Division of Local Services, the state agency that sort of oversees local government finance. Certainly everyone at the local level knows who he is. Before that, he served as the assistant town administrator in the town of Brookline for 17 years or so, a long time. He's been on the job with the state for 2 years now. I think sometimes it probably seems like 20 years there, some mornings, but it's only been 2 years. He's been someone that we know at the MMA. He has served on our policy committees. We have had him present at panels many times. So I'm glad he was invited here, and I'm going to turn it over to Sean.
Great. Thanks, John. So as John said, I did spend 17 years in local government, primarily doing finance, long-range capital planning, long-range financial planning, annual operating budgets. And I was saying to Tom earlier, that's probably the only thing I miss. I don't miss town meeting. I don't miss some of those other fun late nights with FinComs. But that's the stuff I miss most. So it's great that folks are here, with some great people talking about municipal finance. So what I just wanted to do with my 5 minutes was talk briefly about the last couple of years of local aid and a couple of new programs at the state level, and then give a broad overview of some of the things that I like to look at the Division of Local Services, which is a unit of the Department of Revenue. So as you'll hear, and you probably already know, the two of the big streams of revenue from the state to municipalities is something called Unrestricted Government Aid, lovingly called UGA. And the governor has, he campaigned on and has followed through on his promise to grow this account at the same rate as general revenues at the state. The first year, it was an increase of $34 million, which was actually 75% of the growth in state revenues. And then in 17 and 18, the $40-plus million is 100% of state revenue growth. That account is now over $1 billion. That had been cut back very significantly over the previous couple decades. And I'm sure folks here remember those budget cycles when that account was cut very dramatically. Chapter 70, which is a, $5 billion account for education aid. You know, it's one of the most complicated formulas you'll ever try to figure out, but obviously it's extremely important. Fiscal 16, it was a $111 million increase. Fiscal 17, $116 million increase. And the governor proposed $91 million, and the House Ways and Means budget that came out just a couple days ago increased it to $106 million. So you'll get varied thoughts about whether that's enough money or not, but that follows the formula guidelines and actually additional aid per pupil for communities that would otherwise not get any additional revenue. Three new programs just to highlight. One is called the Community Compact Cabinet. Admittedly low levels of revenue associated with it, but it's been a very important and powerful program. Lieutenant Governor Toledo chairs the cabinet. I have the pleasure of being the vice chair, and it's all about helping municipalities with best practices. And I'm sure these folks can tell you that they got 9 million things to do, and they can only get to about 7 million of them. They don't have enough money to do everything they want to do. So what this top program, the best practice program, is all about is having communities tell us at the state level what they would like to do, whether it's improve how they've managed their finances or improve their energy efficiency programs or adopt complete streets policies or whatever. There's a whole range of best practices. We provide grants to the community or in-house technical assistance. And we've got 292 of the 351 communities signed up for the program, so it's been very successful so far. There's a $2 million efficiency and regionalization program. That's, you know, regionalization is a difficult topic in all parts of the state, but I think with the baby boomers about to retire, that it's an extremely timely topic. Communities are having difficulty finding replacement for positions. They might want to join together with other communities to provide services. So we provide basically seed money for communities to explore those opportunities. And then the last one is an IT grant program. We all know IT is expensive, confusing, it changes too frequently. So what we do is we provide a competitive grant program. We're going to be making an announcement in a couple weeks about the winners of that grant award. And it's up to $200,000 for communities to do something innovative with technology. Small Bridges Program, $50 million program over 5 years, maximum grants $500,000, and there's a number of communities here in Worcester County that recently got grants for that, including Charlton, Leominster, Fitchburg, Princeton, Upton, and Westboro. So they got grants up to $500,000 to repair bridges, small bridges that aren't they're not applicable for federal funding. And then another one is Complete Streets. It's a $12.5 million program for the first 2 years, and then there's money in a bond authorization for $50 million over a five-year period after that. And I'm sure you know what the Complete Streets program is all about. It's all about different modes of transportation and getting to make sure everybody can get along in the roads, whether you're a bicyclist or a pedestrian or a car driver, whatever it is. There's technical assistance grants to help you put a plan together, and then once that plan is approved, you're eligible for a construction grant of up to $400,000. And there's 10 communities in Worcester County that have received technical assistance grants for that as well, including Leominster and Worcester, Fitchburg, and Gardner. So These programs, again, not the magnitude of UGA, not the magnitude of Chapter 70, but they're new programs that I think communities have really taken advantage of, and I think they would say that they've been very helpful. So just for the last couple of minutes I have, I want to talk about some, you know, big picture stuff. I'm sure you know what new growth is. New growth is the tax, property taxes that you're able to levy above and beyond your annual 2.5 growth. So Prop 2.5 says take your last year's levy, increase it by 2.5%, and then above and beyond that is new growth. So whether it's, you know, a new subdivision or a new business that comes in and constructs a facility, that's new growth. It's very important to municipal finance. So what I showed here up top, and for each of these slides you'll see I did Worcester County and then non-Worcester County, so you can see how it's different or not different in this part of the state versus the other parts of the state. So the real way to look at new growth is what percent of the prior year levy is it. So if you're able to grow your levy 2.5% under Prop 2.5, and then you're growing it by another 2% because of new growth, that's 2% more tax revenue that you have available to fund those services. So it's a very powerful tool in municipal finance. And what you see here is that, you know, in the early part of these years, Worcester County in the aggregate actually was outperforming the other parts of the state. And now over the last decade or so, they pretty much mirror each other. And then the bottom part shows you the composition between residential and CIP, which is commercial, industrial, personal property. And I think most people, right or wrong, like commercial growth because there's not as much cost associated with it as there is residential. If you have residential growth, you might have children that got to go to the school system. You might have some other services that need to be delivered. So I think the quote-unquote ideal type of new growth is commercial because there's not as much municipal cost associated with it. And then if you look at the trend over time, you'll see that in the early years, Worcester County as a whole was primarily on the residential side, but it's shifted now to be very similar to the rest of the state, which is about a 55-45% split. So pretty similar what's going on out here over the last few years as the rest of the state. Another thing I like to pay particular attention to is I think we all know that the economy might slow down at some point in the near future, and how are communities preparing themselves for that. So there's something called free cash, which is a bad term for basically year-end fund balance as calculated by my shop. And if you have a high level of free cash, it's basically your rainy day fund, so to speak, for if you have any unanticipated expenditures during the course of the year, or if you want to use it for one-time expenses like capital or increase your pension, throw some money in your pension fund or your OPEB fund. What you see here, whether it's Worcester County or the rest of the state, is a good upward trend. So this bodes well, I think, for communities as long as they don't use it for ongoing purposes, because then in the year or two, 3 years, whenever the downturn might occur, this money's gone and you don't have it for one-time purposes. Excess capacity is a term which is the delta between what you can levy in taxes and what you do levy. It's another form of reserve, right? So if you all of a sudden have a budget crunch for whatever the reason might be, say there's a recession and the state budget takes a hit and they got to cut local aid to municipalities, the burden then falls on municipalities and they might say, okay, we need to increase our taxes at a local level. You can do that without an override if you have what's called excess capacity. So it's a very important thing to track in your municipality. Some communities have zero. Brookline literally raised their taxes to the levy limit every single year. We had like $30,000 on a $185 million property tax base. Other communities, Marlboro has $30 million of excess capacity. So, you know, every community is different. But what's important is to, for your own community, see what, you know, the trend is over time. And again, what you see here is that's growing, which again is a good thing, because this gives communities, whether you're Worcester County or the rest of the state, as shown here, that number's grown. So there's some flexibility that communities are going to have over the next few years if they need it. And then the last one is stabilization fund. This is a statutory fund where you appropriate money into, and there's different kinds of funds. There's a true rainy day fund, which is for any municipal purpose, and then there's called special purpose funds, and communities have used it for capital projects, street funds, those types of things. You basically put money in that, whether it's from the property tax levy or one-time revenues, whatever it might be. And you like to build that in the good times so that it's available for you in the bad times. And that's exactly what you see here, both in Worcester County and the rest of the state as a whole. So from kind of where I sit, local aid has been growing, which is good. And municipalities have been doing, in the aggregate, I mean, every community is different, but in the aggregate, communities are doing the right things to prepare themselves for if and when an economic downturn occurs. So that's my probably a little bit more than 5 minutes. So thanks.
Thank you, Sean. I'm glad you mentioned that school finances is part of the local aid program for FY18, and I think perhaps we can circle back to that later on, maybe during questions and answers. I think that's particularly important, you know, with this group here. The business community was certainly instrumental in writing the 1993 education reform law. It is really sort of fundamental to how we pay for our public education here in Massachusetts. Of course, there's a big discussion going on now as to what the next generation of that might look like. So hopefully we can circle back to that a little bit. So next up, if we're doing this alphabetically in any way, is Julie Jacobson, who I'm sure you all know as the Auburn Town Manager, where she has, well, she's been here in Worcester County for 25 years or more, here at the city of Worcester, and some brief stints other places, and then now in the town of Auburn. She's one of our Central Mass rock stars, as is this whole panel. We also have the great fortune that she serves on our board of directors, so I'm happy to have her. So, Julie.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. So I want to show you just a few slides about the town of Auburn and just give you a brief overview. It does a lot of what I'm going to show you mirrors what Sean just showed you on a statewide level. So just to give you an idea, the town of Auburn, for those of you who don't know, is a little south of Worcester, a neighboring community, a little over 16,000 people. Our total budget that we're proposing for FY18 is just shy of $64 million with an operating budget of about $60.5 million. It's about a 3.9% increase over FY17. And we're using, I'll show you that, but we're using 0.99%, so under 1% of what's available to us for Prop 2.5. We haven't taxed to Prop 2.5 for about 8 years, so we try to keep that level. Myself and Ed Kazanovich, who's here today, he's our assistant town manager and CFO, we're very conservative, and we have focused our efforts in the last few years on increasing our reserves and increasing our excess levy, exactly as Sean was saying, just to prepare, just in case. We want to make sure that we have money available if we need it in the future. Our budget this year leaves us with about $625,000 that we have not, we have no intentions of touching right now. Let me see this. So just to show just some of the slides and what we've done, our excess levy, again, we have grown it considerably over the last few years, and we're at a little over $4 million now. If the $625,000 that we're not using in FY18 does go through, our town meeting vote is on May 2nd. If that happens, our excess levy will be about 4.6%. If you look at Mass Inc. And their data on their website, it's interesting. You can compare yourself to your peers, to other communities, to the entire state. Auburn ranks 26th in the state for dollar-wise for excess levy capacity, which I think is very good. I'm going to show you one more on excess levy. Here is our history, and what we're trying to show is that we're not using everything that's available to us under Proposition 2.5. We intentionally try to stay at that 1 to 1.25% level. We try not to get above that. Every now and then we do, and usually we adjust it back downwards at the fall town meeting. We have instituted a number of written financial policies that guide us when we develop our budgets, and these have been approved and adopted by the Board of Selectmen as well as the Finance Committee. Part of these policies provide for us to use 1/10 of Prop 2.5 to set aside for capital, because we're on a plan over the next few years to no longer borrow for any of our capital needs, other than a large facility project like a school. We want to make sure that all of our facility needs and all of our capital needs will be met within the operating budget. We no longer want to be borrowing and incurring that debt service. So it's really important to us to try to keep those levels low. Our free cash, we've grown that significantly. I know there was a slide up there a minute ago that Sean showed. In FY10, we had $271,000 in free cash. And in FY16, our last certification, 17 hasn't been certified yet, we had $9,385,000. So we have significantly grown it. This is important to us because it's there as a backup. We do not use any of it for operating. A financial policy was put into place in FY10 that dwindled down the use of free cash until, I believe, FY13 was the last year that we used any free cash. So we have not used any of it in our operating. We do have a financial policy that we have proposed that to the Board of Selectmen and the Finance Committee that recommends that when we reach our benchmark, and for us, our benchmark is 20% reserves, we want to hit the 20% reserve mark because that's where Moody's Investor Service has said that communities of an AA+ rating should be on their reserves. We have proposed a financial policy that says that after we reach that 20%, 50% of the free cash could potentially be used to offset our OPEB or other one-time capital needs, keeping 50% growing in that account. OPEB, we started an OPEB fund in FY13. Out of our operating budget, we put $500,000 every year toward OPEB. Last year, we did have excess dollars again that we gave money back to the taxpayers, and then we also made a recommendation, which was approved, to put another $100,000 into our OPEB. We're going to continue to do that. If there's money available to do that, it's an issue. We need to address it. Our OPEB liability is $67 million. If we were fully funding it, it would be about $2.6 million a year. So even at $500,000, it's a start, but it's certainly not the level that we need to be for the long term. Roadway improvement program, this is something that we really focus our attention on as well as in our budget. In addition to our Chapter 90 dollars, town puts in $525,000 every year out of our operating budget. We also put in nearly another $500,000 out of other sources, whether it be capital or sewer, into our roadway system. So we're putting about $1.5 million in annually for a roadway program. We have a 20-year plan to redo every road in the town of Auburn over the 20 years. Our unassigned fund balance as a percent of our general operating revenue, this is consists of free cash and stabilization. This is the 20% benchmark that I was mentioning to you. We just want to make sure that we got to that benchmark. It's important to us to keep our bond rating. We have a AA+ with Standard & Poor's and a AA2 with Moody's, and that 20% is very critical to us to keep that level. Total reserves in the town, we have $30 million, and this includes OPEB, excess levy, stabilization, free cash, CIP, health trust, pension reserve, so our reserves are strong. And our new growth history, we're averaging about $701,000 annually over a five-year. The last 2 years have been up over $860,000. When we budget about $475,000 of that, and that's why we're conservative. We have that extra growth. We don't want to count on it. We know it's there, but we're doing our best not to use it. I think just to finish up, we're supposed to just mention a couple of the challenges, and I'm sure you're going to hear this from others, but our challenges primarily are going to be the same as everybody else: snow and ice, OPEB, health, increasing costs of health. In addition, I think other communities may say this as well, but also trying to deal with the challenge of increasing special ed and out-of-district placement costs. Very, very expensive to communities. If you have to send a child to another district that your district can't provide for either their physical or their emotional needs, and you have to send them, some of those costs exceed $100,000 a year for tuition and transportation. That's a lot of money for someone who may be going, a six-year-old who may be going into first grade, and then that the town owns that child and that educational plan up until they're 22. So you're talking a lot of money. Five children who need to have a plan like that can cost the town $500,000. So that's something that we're all grappling with. Collective bargaining, trying to keep within our contractual needs, that's a challenge. Aging infrastructure for a community like us, we have to look at that. That's a cost for the future. Maintaining our municipal facilities is a huge cost. They're There is a financial piece to that that we have to plan. We have a five-year, a short-term plan for non-capital items to take care of every building in town, and we upgrade that every year. We do that again. We're looking at both borrowing and not borrowing to fix these needs. Again, ultimately, we don't want to use any of our borrowing. We want to just use our tax levy and be creative about it. And lastly, just on health insurance, we're all facing it. Last year, Town of Auburn was told we were going to have a 12% increase in our health insurance, which is $1 million. We negotiated with all of our unions on the town and school side. We have 16 unions, and we had to get unanimous approval of 16 unions to make changes to health care. We did that, and we reduced that down from 12% to 2%. This year, we're facing another 10% increase. We've instituted an opt-out program. We've increased our co-pays and deductibles. We've become creative with our health care, but it's an ongoing problem, just as OPEB is. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Julie. Certainly what we heard as the problems in Auburn are things that we hear across the state, particularly with health insurance, which continues to be a big issue. Next up is Dan Morgado, who you all know is the Shrewsbury town manager. Dan is leaving, but not really before establishing himself as a legend here in central Massachusetts, which I guess is the Shrewsbury way. Dan has been in Shrewsbury for 20 years, and before that he had some town administrator experience, other Worcester County towns. I think one point in time you were actually outside of Worcester County and in Easton perhaps, but he came back, which is a good thing for everyone. We have enjoyed Dan's expertise a lot in sort of policy development at the MMA. He served as our designee on the OPEB Commission, the Special OPEB Commission in 2012. We needed someone with a steel spine to represent us there, and so we called on Dan, and he did that. They came up with a great report and some great recommendations to educate people on the issue of OPEB. Unfortunately, we have not seen those recommendations make their way into law yet, so it's something we're still working on. So, Dan, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I just want to, I've been either attending or participating in Research Bureau programs now for just about 30 years. I did 10 years with the town of Grafton before going to be just about 20 years when I retire from Shrewsbury, and I just want to congratulate the Research Bureau for the work it does, focusing on the economy and effectiveness of government is very, very important. The needed changes in how we conduct business is critical to the financial survival of our various municipalities, and the work being done under the previous administration and certainly under the current administration as represented by Sean is so very, very important that work continues. So the work of the Worcester Bureau, the work of the Boston Municipal Research Bureau, and the work that's being done by ANF, particularly with the community compacts, so critically important. To first shine a light on the need for reform and change and for capacity to be created, and then to provide the tools to make that happen. So there's going to be a lot of great things coming out of that community compact program, and I think everyone just needs to stay tuned because the communities are heavily engaged in it, as you heard with the town of Auburn, and if you brought in so many of the communities of Worcester County, they're all heavily engaged in looking at how can we provide high levels of service to our residents at an affordable price. The other thing you would hear from municipalities as they get up, every municipality has a narrative that's very unique to that particular community because we continually be so dependent on property taxes and geographic location. Location, location, location. In Shrewsbury's case, Shrewsbury's location being to the east of the center city of Worcester, developing predominantly after the Second World War as a suburban community with two highways where the traditional zoning of take the center line, measure X number of feet from the center line, that becomes your commercial industrial zone, everything else becomes residential. That's how Shrewsbury developed. So Shrewsbury is predominantly a residential community. In 20 years, or nearly 20 years in Shrewsbury, when I started back in 1997, we had 3,900 children in our school system. We now have a little over 6,000 children in our school system. And when you look at cost centers, as pointed out, the providing a quality education to our children is an immensely expensive enterprise. So when you look at the makeup of the community, in Shrewsbury's case, heavily residential, 87% residential, we have a $12.83 flat tax rate. Okay, let me say that again, $12.83 flat tax rate. When Sean talked about new growth, when you look at the Lakeway Commons project being built on the former Spaggs property, open by there to see that? Remarkable, isn't it? When that all that new growth comes on, it's going to come on at $12.83, as opposed to another community that might have $14, $15, $18, $20, $24 tax rate. So that's a real dollars and cent change and difference between what will happen in one community to the next. So when you do the analysis of community to community, you'll see there are great differences in how that community is able to gather revenue, but also where are the spending areas for that particular community. We mentioned health insurance earlier. When people say, what are my largest departments? Well, my largest department is obviously the school department. What's my second largest department? It's my Department of Health Insurance. We spend in Shrewsbury, or we'll spend in Shrewsbury, if you take my police department, fire department, highway department combined, that's about what we'll spend on health insurance. So communities that are able to marshal resources, are able to create levy capacity, are able to create the ability to handle the downturn, they're going to be in a very good position, because that health insurance number, unless something is done dramatically, is going to continue to erode any new revenue that is either produced from the local tax levy, reduced from the what I would call the activity taxes, which is your meals tax and your hotel taxes, and anything that the state aid is going to be able to provide. So as an overview in Shrewsbury, we'll go to town meeting. It'll be my 39th annual town meeting, believe it or not, and final. And we'll allocate revenue as best we can. We'll use our full levy capacity, because that's what we have to do. And we'll continue to maintain our reserve positions as described, as we're all trying to do, because the time to budget for the downturn is during the good times, not during the tough times. And we need to constantly be aware of that. And I could not possibly sit down without talking about OPEB. Research Bureau recently put out a report relative to OPEB, and I know I'm preaching to the choir here, but we need to continually talk about the need for the reforms to be put in place, reasonable reforms to be put in place, in order to allow communities the tools to deal with this situation. Shrewsbury's case, we expect to have based upon our most recent pension valuation, we expect to have our pension system fully funded. Our public goal is 2022. In fact, I have a banner in my office that says 2022 a bust. We're actually looking at 2020. For a community of with the challenges that Shrewsbury's had with its growth, the fact that we have such a low tax rate, to have a fully funded pension system in 2020 will put us in a very unique set of communities on a statewide basis. Plan at that time will be is to take a major portion. I would hope that the town manager at that time will be able to, and I'm sure this will be the case, take a major portion of what was going into the pension allocation and begin to adopting a funding schedule for OPEB and put the town in a very strong financial position in the future. So I don't have any slides, by the way, so that's why I'm stalling. I feel like I failed to do my homework correctly, and I'm sure Mr. Cronin will admonish me appropriately. Thank you very much.
Yeah, that was the best kind of old school presentation.
I was channeling my inner Mr. Connie.
There you go. All right. Last up, Tom, and I think with your last name, you're usually the last up if we go alphabetically, is Tom Zidelis, who serves as the City of Worcester's Chief Financial Officer. I think when you were welcomed back to the city 10 years ago, I think the city manager at the time referred to you as a seasoned professional. That's 10 years ago. I don't know, 10 years hence, what comes after seasoning, but perhaps you can tell us.
Thanks, Sean. You want to talk about pressure on a presentation. How do you bat cleanup after Dan Morgado? I mean, it's. I was sitting there, you know, trying to think about what I was going to say. And one thing I will say is all three of us share the same struggles, challenges. The only difference is with Worcester, it's more zeros at the end. You know, whether it be OPEB, health insurance. One underlying theme, if I could, and I have to apologize, the city manager is just wrapping up his budget. We met with our final department yesterday. In a month, we'll be presenting it to our city council for their deliberations. But one underlying theme with any budget is that you should have taken is financial planning. As you know, by Dan's success, they've had plans in place, as Julie inferred to, Auburn's developing plans. The city's FY18 budget will be developed under the auspices of our existing five-point plan that was enacted in November of 2006. The five-point plan had many facets, conservative budgeting, the establishment and creation of reserves. An amendment we made approximately 4 years ago was the establishment of an OPEB trust fund. But like any good document, it changes with the time. And City Manager Augustus has before the City Council, who adopted, endorsed, and followed the five-point plan, a current update. As both Dan and Julie said, the city's five-point plan or financial plan recognizes long-term liabilities. The biggest one, the 800-pound gorilla currently before any municipality, is OPEB. The Fair City has adopted a two-pronged approach to addressing the OPEB liability. One was the establishment of an OPEB trust, which we started funding approximately 3 years ago. The initial infusion of cash into the trust was $500,000 plus 50% of free cash. Currently before the city council, and with us we have one of our city councilors, what we have is an amendment where, besides keeping the 50% of the free cash, we're proposing increasing the allocation from the operating budget 10% a year. Currently, it's a modest level, but the City of Worcester has built up a OPEB trust of approximately $12 million. Also with the FY18 budget, we're looking for identification of collaboratives and efficiencies. As Sean spoke to, the City of Worcester recognized the importance of regionalism a few years ago. With Dan Morgado, we developed a regional public health where Worcester provides services, you know, albeit compensated by the towns, regional public health. Recently, last August, we opened a rec center where we provide dispatching 911 calls to Worcester and the town of Leicester. So that center city approach, as Dan spoke to, is inevitable for the long-term stability of Worcester and our surrounding neighbors. Finally, with the FY18 budget, we're looking for the identification of new funding sources. We realize the tax levy can't support everything. So, with the state's assistance, we have the DCU Special District Fund supporting, the state supporting the downtown with an augmentation of funding to improve the DCU in its environs. Also, with the City Square project, the manager recommended to council and the council adopted a community fund for the Worcester Common, where revenues coming from the City Square garage are supporting the common activities and events. So, consistent with prior years, the fiscal year 18 budget will continue that mantra with alternative funding measures above and beyond the tax levy. On the revenue side, getting back to Sean's point, and to Julie's point, the city has seen new growth increases over the last few years above and beyond what we saw in the, you know, 10 years before. The city of Worcester currently, the budget as it's being formulated is capturing the full 2.5% growth, and we're capturing new growth at a level of in excess of 4.5 million. As Sean spoke to, Worcester has, you know, seen an uptick in new growth with, if you look around the horizon, a lot of new buildings, both downtown and in the peripheral of the city. That is generating substantial new growth compared to 10 years ago, and it's very beneficial as we build the FY18 budget. In terms of state aid, as Sean made reference to, the city of Worcester is very appreciative of the governor's support of local efforts. In terms of the unrestricted general government aid, the city, with the increases Sean spoke to, the city will receive $1.6 million in new state aid growth supporting municipal services. Also of note, Sean spoke to the increase in state aid for schools. With the governor and the lieutenant governor in the legislature, we're expecting to see approximately $9.9 million going directly to the Worcester Public Schools to support education in the city of Worcester. The last funding source for the Fair City is local receipts, which has been conservatively estimated, as is the case in previous years. The city of Worcester has a steady stream of local receipts, and our conservative approach to budgeting that revenue source will continue into FY18. On the expense side, it comes down to the priority set by our city council, the investment in community priorities. Public safety, public schools, youth programs, public health, and public works. Not necessarily in that order, just in case. I don't want to get myself in trouble, but this is our core delivery of service. And all of them, as Joy spoke to, as she spoke to public schools, all of them have evolved from the point before I was a seasoned veteran coming back to the city of Worcester. Public safety, as in any urban center, police, fire, communications, are our core functions in terms of public safety. Keeping the classes up in both police and fire and having a dispatcher to take the calls are extremely important. Relative to public schools, the city managers is very high on public education. There was a brief period, you know, the city of Worcester always met the minimum contribution as described by the Department of Education, and tried to attain the net school spending. This city manager has increased public dollars into the tax levy dollars into the public schools consistently for his last three budgets above and beyond what is required by the minimum contribution. And that, you know, as he says, dollars into the classroom. The city manager also recognizes the youth are our future. With last year's budget and this year's budget, the recreational programs, Rec Worcester, as he refers to it, will be continued and possibly expanded in the FY18 budget. Public health, if we're not here for anything else, public health in our safety net to the people who need it is being expanded through the reorganization of health and human services. And finally, public works. Julie speaks to streets. You know, Worcester, back to Dan's point, Worcester developed before Shrewsbury, and before World War II. We're an older city with older infrastructure. The city, the city manages priority to building walkable streets and having the utilities underneath said streets are critical in terms of us and development in the future. So it's almost like setting, back into Mr. McGurthy's former life when we used to talk about ED. Our job is to get the city pad ready for development or residential expansion coming in. And finally, reserves. Dan spoke to building up reserves in the good times. Worcester, going back prior to the five-point plan, had marginal reserves. We also saw the critical nature of said reserves as we embarked on the Great Recession. The city of Worcester has built up substantial reserves since 2009, and as Dan said, to weather the storm. We continue to try to achieve additional reserves for the next downturn. But once again, in terms of financial planning, reserve levels are what is going to keep Worcester being a going concern. So with that, I thank you.
Thanks, Tom. I think throughout the comments that Sean made in our three panels, we've seen some common problems that were raised, some common challenges, and certainly health insurance is one of them, maintaining long-term balances, maintaining your infrastructure, in a state of good repair, all kinds of long-term sort of spending side challenges. On the revenue side, I think there was a thread there that while there is high property tax reliance, and that's something sort of be managed, at the same time you're trying to build up reserves. So I think we want to spend sort of a couple minutes talking about common challenges and then talk about common solutions to problems. So I don't know, perhaps I've got them with that, or there are others there that you see as common?
Yeah, I think one of the things that I didn't mention, and it might have been mentioned earlier, the human infrastructure aspect of what we're doing. So it was mentioned earlier, I think demographically, what's happening in this business, and the need to attract young professionals and encourage people within our organization to self-develop people within our organizations to bring forward leadership positions in every department and in every aspect, particularly on the financial control side of things. If anyone's, for instance, put out an advertisement for positions, the number of people applying for jobs or wanting a career in the public sector, and I've been involved with Clark University for a number of years, as others have, and it's very important that we talk about, where is the next generation? I'm talking like I'm a real old guy, huh? where the next generation is going to be coming in from. I was lucky to come into this business initially when I was 21. I was elected by home planning board, and then so I've been in this a long time, and we need to think about how do we get that next generation involved, how do we train, and that's why I think the municipal compact work that's being done and a lot of the work being done on infrastructure is so important.
I'm glad you raised that point. That's something we do hear across the state, particularly when it comes to municipal finance, public finance. It's really hard to find people sort of at the full range from entry-level positions right up through CFOs. Anybody else want to weigh in on sort of common challenges How about figuring out federal revenues or what's going on in the federal government over the next couple of years?
Yeah, I'll give the microphone for that.
Yeah.
Thanks. The biggest component with the city of Worcester with federal revenues are the Worcester Public Schools.
Yeah.
On our side, we do have numerous federal grants on the city side coming through the Department of Justice. So there's some uncertainty right now in terms of, you know, the support of police and fire with grants coming, you know, coming out of the Department of Justice with the recent statements that have been made on a federal level. So we are being overly cautious as we go down the path of developing budgets, developing grant budgets. But yeah, that uncertainty is something that is on our watch list at the moment.
Yeah, there certainly seems to be a lot out there, and that's one of those areas where it might be good to have, you know, high level of reserves to sort of buffer you against any sort of surprises that come. Not necessarily in FY18, but 19 in years after. Common solutions to problems. Now, I think, Dan, you mentioned sort of, or maybe Tom, you mentioned sort of regional solutions to problems. You mentioned the emergency dispatch that your city is now doing for other communities. Are there other things that we're seeing here in Central Mass about common solutions to problems?
I think the focus has to continue to be on cost structures, looking at you know, why you're spending money and how you're spending it, and how much of that is the result of, you know, regulatory compliance. You know, there's recently the Municipal Modernization Act that was enacted to provide some additional flexibilities. I think that kind of very systematic discussion and review is very, very important, because it can't just be, you know, there's some that always sort of look at this as a revenue solution, and it can't be looked at as a revenue solution. It has to be looked at also, you know, how you're spending money, you know, why you're spending money, how can you spend money differently. You know, the city of Worcester was just outstanding when, you know, I had the opportunity at a public retirement. You know, we always, Shrewsbury's done a lot with contracting and privatization and that. We've always done it in a very humane manner. We've always done it at opportunities when they've been retirements or reductions, voluntary reductions. So we had the opportunity to do the public health, and you know, Mike O'Brien was into that, and we were able to get the necessary approvals through the city council and through my board of selectmen, and what became two communities. I think we're up to six communities now, and where we're providing better service, and we're doing it at a reasonable, controlled cost. You know, the strength of the center city is so important, and that's something that you know, I've been engaged in very heavily, both with Grafton and Shrewsbury, the importance to recognize the leadership role that the city plays, and the ability to make fair, you know, the reason why regionalism, I think, has failed in many areas was there's always this attitude that communities were trying to get the best of each other. But if you come to the table and say, you know, how do we have a transaction that makes us both better off, that's how you're able to have true collaboration. So I'm so pleased to hear the other, because we all can't do everything. We have to think about, you know, how do we avoid duplication of services, but how do we do it in a way that recognizes local control? So in the case of our public health endeavor, although we have this regional health alliance, every community retains its own individual board of health to make those, in some instances, tweaks of local understanding, local policy, reflective of that community. And I think that is so, that's a great model. And there are other models out there that I think, as we get this demographic shift, communities need to take advantage of, gee, do we really need to fill this position? Is there a different way of approaching this? And at that point in time, you're able to make these changes without any sense of threat, or people feel that might be threatened, or taking action like in a unilateral fashion. I think those tools, I think that intermunicipal act that was adopted a few years ago that made intermunicipal agreements easier to do, that was a great piece of legislation. And obviously the MMA is so critically important in getting that accomplished.
And you know, picking up where Dan left off, it's extremely important. And put it this way, to your credit, it was a partnership, and it continues to be a partnership. We constantly are looking at that, but when you have somebody that was accommodating, and you talk about tearing down, you know, barriers, walls, or allowing us to, you know, go over the Quincy Bridge.
It's a beautiful bridge.
It's a beautiful bridge. It's those collaborations. But they go beyond that. But back to your point, sharing ideas. You know, I speak with Julie constantly. Now that I have caller ID, it's going to go down. It's going to go down some. But our, you know, Worcester health inspectors being in Shrewsbury can observe stuff and come back. And in Worcester, you know, we don't have all the, you know, ideas. We don't have all the solutions. But that collaborative nature, expanding it beyond just health, coming back and, you know, they may be in City Hall, you know, in the town hall and say, hey, did you see this? You know, we constantly look at other people's web pages. Back to where, you know, Sean came from, we're grabbing ideas from their web pages. So it's, we're not an island. We've, you know, never been an island. But we have to, beyond sharing services, we need to, you know, to continue sharing ideas.
I think to follow up on that, there are a couple of different ways that communities need to stay involved with collaboration and sharing ideas, whether you're in a formal regional partnership or not. Through the Mass Municipal Association. You know, it's a great opportunity, whether you're part of the, as I'm fortunate to be on the executive board, or as the MMMA, which is the Mass Municipal Managers Association, or the Mass Selectmen's Association. The MMMA brings groups together within their discipline, and you can share ideas informally, you can share contracts, strategies for collective bargaining, you can share ideas on what are you doing in-house to get rid of some of your vendor costs. And then on the state level, Sean mentioned it, the Community Compact. Again, I'm fortunate to be part of the Community Compact Cabinet. And the Lieutenant Governor meets with us and listens to the concerns that we've raised and then addresses them with programs. We had raised a concern last year about the difficulty in attracting, as Dan and others mentioned it, difficulty in attracting people for certain positions now that are very, very technical. You need to have technical skills to be a treasurer, to be an assessor. Those types of fields, it's going to be difficult in the future. And when we raised that issue, within a couple of months, the Lieutenant Governor had added, through her team, had added this to the Community Compact as the ability to apply for a grant to get a program like that going. So those collaborations are really critical.
And the great thing at those compact meetings is the communities come together and the thirst of the communities, give us the tools, give us the ability, allow us the ability to do the collaboration. That's so clearly the theme in all of those meetings. Do you want to talk on that?
Yeah, we have a couple of things together. Just on the Community Compact stuff, I mean, again, with my background being in the town hall, I wanted it to be, let the communities have some flexibility, not the state telling the municipalities this is what you need to do or this is what you should do. We're saying, hey, here's some resources, please take advantage of us, and, you know, we'll all be better off for it. So it's a very different approach, and I think the historical state-local relationship. Then just to take the regionalization theme and the theme of, now I'm going to sound old, getting the next generation of people. Like Dan, I was fortunate enough to start pretty young too. Now I don't feel so young, but it's a real need. The Lieutenant Governor hears it relatively frequently. We're going to be doing something with that in partnership with MMA and others. But what we've started to work on with some communities is coming up with a regional finance model. I mean, it kills me that each community has their own assessing, operation, collection, treasury, budgeting, comptroller / accounting, you know. And in a lot of primarily smaller towns, you know, Massachusetts, the average population in Massachusetts is 18, or the median is 18, no, the average is 18,500, I think the median is 10,000. 75% of the communities have a population of less than 20,000 people. So we're a commonwealth of small towns. We love our quaint New England towns, right? But as we start losing those seasoned veterans to retirement, you know, who's going to come in? It's going to be very difficult for the smaller towns primarily to find a full-time accountant, to find a full-time collector treasurer. And I admit, I was in my little Brookline bubble world and wasn't paying much attention to what was going on in other parts. Once you lose a good quality accountant or a good quality treasurer, things go south quickly. And it takes a long time to recover from that. And so what we're working with some communities with is, okay, now you're at that point. Let us work with you and help you through trying to work together. We've got six hill towns working together on a regional finance model, where instead of having five or six part-time people for each community, it's going to be, if they adopt it, you know, one real finance model for the six towns. It will save them money. They'll be a heck of a lot more efficient in what they do. They'll probably be more accurate in their accounting as well. So for me, that discussion needs to be had in more places. And I know it's difficult. I mean, in Brookline, I wouldn't have wanted to have to depend, quote unquote, depend on some other town for, you know, my account. But with cloud-based financial systems these days, I mean, you can have a central CFO approving whatever he or she needs to approve. You know, it's very different than it was 20 years ago, whatever. And if it doesn't happen over the next few years with the large number of retirements, it will never happen. I mean, this is the time to really start having those conversations. They're difficult, but I really think that a number of communities, a sizable number of communities, can really be benefited by taking that type of approach, rather than just continuing to do what we've always done for 200 or 300 years.
I know people need to move on to other things, but we have some time for questions, if there are any out here, or comments.
John, what do you think, any movement on the OPED commission recommendations in this legislature?
You know, I wish I could say I'm optimistic, but I'm not. There are a lot of other issues that seem to have moved ahead of OPEP. So, no, I'm not really sure. Certainly this year, I'm not seeing it as part of the legislative agenda for this year. We haven't heard it, you know, certainly from legislative leadership, that's the direction they want to move in. So we're going to stay at it, but not what I'm hearing right now.
What about the state administration of Sean?
Well, I know Sean's the biggest cheerleader, or one of the biggest cheerleaders in the executive side on it.
It's absolutely on the radar screen, and there's been discussions about it. It's not something that is not known about.
Someday, when the big three meet, that Monday morning meeting with the Senate President and the Speaker and the Governor and the Lieutenant Governor, someday someone will say, let's do OPEB and we'll move forward. But I just don't think we'll reach that point.
John, if I may, I heard Dan's got some time coming up that he could really
there you go. Put them on the payroll. Any other questions or comments?
There's a lot of kind of the potential negative impacts of federal cutbacks, but one of the elements that could be a positive is the infrastructure funding that's been talked about. Do you have any insight into whether it is real and has legs, and is there any advanced planning or at least anticipation going on at the local level for potential new funds for infrastructure?
Well, I'll take the second part of the question. You know, there's always a misnomer that projects are shovel ready. In order to do a project based upon the current, you know, regulatory environment, there's a lot that goes into getting a project ready. So if in fact infrastructure money were to come through, communities would really be hard-pressed, unless they had a strong reserve position, to get the necessary resources together, to get projects, unless they already had projects. We, in Shrewsbury's case, we always have traditionally had a project or two on the board so that we could react to funding, but I don't know if that capacity exists in every community. So, you know, communities need to turn that switch is going to be, we saw that, I think, with the stimulus program, Brent. It's very, very hard. We're doing a road project right now. The new regulations on how to acquire right-of-way change where we have actually had to hire two appraisers, one appraiser to do the appraiser, another appraiser to review the appraiser or the first appraiser. So I think that concurrent with any stimulus program or infrastructure program, I think we need to look at the regulatory environment as to, you know, how these projects can be built. You know, obviously observing everyone's interests, but understanding that a successful infrastructure project is only successful when it gets built. And that would be my two cents. But we'd look forward to the opportunity because, look, we all have issues, you know, bridges, roads, culverts. This whole issue, we didn't have a chance to talk about the work that we've all done on a collaborative basis with stormwater management. What's that whole stormwater management aspect going to be? Those NPDES permits go live for us, at least for Shrewsbury's case, on July 1, I suspect, and for the rest of the communities as well. What is that going to mean from a funding standpoint? Many of us are talking about creating a new utility in order to fund those costs. Well, if we're charging folks this new utility cost, you know, there's almost so much there in the pot. So, how do we, take in funding for, stormwater management compliance, and then talk about how do you go back for a property tax increase, or how do you go back for a rate increase for whatever? The need, I've said this for many years, we can do everything. Okay, we have the capacity and the interests to do everything. We just can't do it all at one time, and there always seems to be this sense that we're going to do everything at one time. And so, if infrastructure suddenly comes in, how do we have the management capacity to do that? And that's something we have to plan for.
I think it's important, in addition to looking at the regional collaborations, that as a municipality, you look at your own internal structure and see if you can make any type of organizational changes as far as capacity building. But what have you been doing for 20 years, and is that necessarily the right thing to be doing? 5-6 years ago, we did a complete reorganization plan. We went from 25 different departments down to 8. We combined their resources. We shared staff. We shared equipment. We stopped having to go out and hire 50 different individual plow operators during our storms. We took it in-house, and now we created a DPW department. Everybody who comes into DPW is trained to go out and plow the roads so we can bring our resources in. We looked at all of our vendor contracts, what we take inside, as opposed to relying on the economy and what the rates are, what can we do internally? So we started a facility management division within DPW. So facility management, we actually have a staff that goes out and does all the improvements to all of our buildings, as opposed to going out to bid for it and paying outside contract rates. We brought all our fleet maintenance in-house. So now we maintain all of our fleet, both on fire, police, DPW, and any of our administrative vehicles in-house, because those contracts were excessive. We've saved probably $1 million on our facility management so far, and every year, it's small dollars compared to our city, but on our fleet maintenance, we're saving probably $70,000 to $100,000 a year that we used to pay out. So I think it's important to look at what your sources are that are coming in, but also how you do your own operations, and if you can make some shifts within your own operations and save resources, and again, share equipment, potentially share staff across departmental levels, then you can also create some savings in-house as well.
A key theme of all this is planning. You know, for me, when you heard planning, it was zoning. I don't want to listen to zoning. But real financial planning, management planning. You know, the communities that are well situated financially, they plan. And the communities that aren't in such good positions, ask them for a capital plan. They'll ask you, what are you talking about? You know, ask them for a set of financial policies. They're like, what are those? That's been a reoccurring theme. And I think the proof is pretty clear. If a community spends the time, and it costs money, but Julie just said, they step back and they I can assume you spent some money to step back and look at what you did, and now you're saving money, so the payback is probably very short. But it's difficult, especially in a town environment, to go to town meeting and say, hey, we'd like to get X dollars to study something. Why do you need to do it? You got a town manager, let him or her do it, right? But that theme of planning, especially when you're going to have a pretty sizable change in employment or employees, potentially employment levels too. That's really important, and that's one of the things we are trying to do through this community compact program, is help communities do that. Give them the money, go hire the consultant, and take that 30,000 feet above sea level view, see what's going on. But it's really planning. I mean, if you don't plan well, you know, whether it's a sport or local government, you know, you ain't gonna perform well. So.
Okay, so that's like the final word, planning.
There you go.
Planning solves your problem. It was great fun being here, and I'm gonna turn it over to Tim for the thank yous and the wrap up.
Yeah, no, I want to thank the panel. That was great, very insightful, and you covered the range of issues that we're sure to face not just next year, but years going forward. Thank you to all who could attend. Councilor Bear, I'm sorry, I missed you at the beginning. Thank you for attending, all who could be here. These are the types of opportunities we look forward to, kind of, again, to get a little bit of information about where is government, where is it going, and hopefully find ways to improve going forward. So thank you all for coming, and thank you, Commerce Bank. And we'll see you all. Our next event is the Thomas Green Awards towards the end of April. We hope you can be there to help honor those who do a great job in local government, the talent that you're talking about for the next generation.